Welcome everyone to Wrestling Rewind here on the Jeff Meacham Network. No, it's not NTS. I had that for about a day and had talked to people and said, it's lame. It's the reasoning behind it was okay in my mind, but it didn't work out for marketing purposes. So we are back on the Jeff Meacham Network. I am the West Coast Professor Jeff Meacham. Joining me via Skype, not just on audio. Oh no, sir. Joining me via video for the first time because we're trying something new today. So if you hear that we're on video and you're only hearing audio, it's because the experiment failed freaking miserably. But Greg Cherry, what is up, brother? How are you, sir?
Just another day in quarantine for me. Right. and pretty much the entire world, which...
That's it. Yeah, I don't know where you guys are back in Pennsylvania, but Governor Newsom locked us all down at the end of last week. So we are on full shutdown here.
Yeah, Governor Wolf shut down all businesses that didn't affect like daily life. Like,
right.
I forget what the terminology he used was.
Non-essential.
And businesses that are life-sustaining, so like hospitals, like gas stations, grocery stores, stuff like that, that stays open. Restaurants are purely takeout right now.
Yes.
I still work from home, so like that didn't affect me at all.
Right.
So I still have gainful employment at the moment.
It's been kind of crazy. I mean, the schools are shut down until at least May 5th as of now, at least here in Southern California. So the boy's home. And because my parents work out of the house almost every day, because they both work in an employment where they need to be at work as far as their essential places, you know, my son's family is not comfortable having him out of the house at their house. So he's here every day.
I mean, it's crazy times we live in. But at least there are things in this day and age, like the WWE Network, where we can still enjoy the things that we enjoy and kind of take our minds off of what's going on in the world.
That is what the Jeff Meacham Network is all about, is, you know, having you guys fire up the YouTube or Anchor or wherever you may be listening to this and go, you know what, I'm checking out for a half hour or so and just doing my own thing. So what Greg and I are going to try to do, and what I'm going to try to do later in post, so but again, bear with me here. We've got arguably the greatest WrestleMania match of all time prior to 2009 queued up. It is from WrestleMania 3. It is Randy Savage and Ricky Steamboat, of course, for the Intercontinental Championship. This is, without question, as Tony Schiavone would say, the standard bearer of WrestleMania matches, at least in the 80s and into the 90s and early 2000s. So it's, you know, it is the match that defined the Intercontinental Championship for the better part of a generation. And we watched WrestleMania 4 last show, and that was quite the adventure.
that was exhausting. And you know what? The sad thing is, like I'm glad I finally had the opportunity to watch the entire WrestleMania, but it wasn't even that good for WrestleMania.
No, it was so bad. It was, it's one of the, WrestleMania 4 lives in lore because of Randy becoming the champion, but the train wreck to arrive at the station was just, yikes.
Yeah, the Battle Royal and the main event were like the two big parts of the show for me, because the Battle Royal at least provided like slow babyface turn of the Hart Foundation, so.
Right. So, but we are here now. I decided to skip out on the NWO versus Austin Rock match because it really wasn't, you know, I mean, yes, it was a key moment in history when you think about it, but it really didn't affect things long-term for us here on the network. So I decided that we'll watch it next year, watch another time. So I wanted to get to this because it is a great match, and the package they put together to build it up is still amazing too. The interviews are great with Ricky and Randy, and it's really, really good. So if for whatever reason the little video isn't in the lower right-hand corner of your screen right now, or you're listening to this on audio and you don't want to, you know, mess with my YouTube, and, you know, that's what everyone do. We are on the WWE Network. We're in WrestleMania 3. We are queued over to 1 hour, 41 minutes, and 15 seconds. You should, in theory, be looking at a long shot of the Silver Dome, right, Hulkster? as the aftermath of the Coco Beware Butch Reed match cleared the ring. And Lord knows, we should watch that match too, because Butch Reed is the greatest of all time. But we're going to go ahead and skip that, and we're going to move on to, you know, a slightly more important match than that. And we're going to go ahead and let everybody get there for a second. I had a chance to talk to you before we, again, we're at 1 hour, 41 minutes, 15 seconds as you guys are queuing up there on the network. Where are you right now on the current product? Because, you know, I didn't get a chance to watch your live stream last weekend because I was indisposed at the time. And as we're recording this, you're doing one tomorrow on the 22nd, which is my dad's birthday, number one, and an MRI for me, number two. So I will not be at the house pretty much, you know, on YouTube for the majority of the day. So right. Where are you at in the current product? Where are you?
Well, I stay caught up with all the like WWE top tens and stuff, which I don't even think they've been doing. They might still be doing them with the empty arena shows, but you know, this would be the perfect time to pipe in that tape SmackDown crowd noise, wouldn't it? Right. Because at least that would add something to the show. Like at least dead crowd with a SmackDown, you never knew for like the first 16 years of the show's existence. But an empty arena match with Rock and Mankind in 99 was one thing. That was intentional. That was designed that way. It's fine. Doing it with the entire show, going to be hard to invest, especially with Mania now being a two-day thing. Yeah, and they're talking about doing it in different venues a la WrestleMania 2. So it's...
It's going to be a very interesting weekend next weekend, for sure. It's going to be very interesting to see how they pull this off because, you know, again, our world is totally different from where it was last time you and I sat down to do one of these. So it's a completely different landscape now. So we'll see what happens.
And you know, I don't want to discount AEW either because they're going through the same thing. And like it's tough for them because they're still less than a year into their actual like company's existence. So what do they do?
Last week's Dynamite was pulled off very well, I thought. We'll see how they do tonight on TNT. But last week's show was, I thought, very well done with a minimal amount of active participation from people. It still came off very well. You had Matt Hardy debuting, you had Brody Lee debuting. It's just, you know, it's one of those things where the stars aligned. It's like when Hall and Nash debuted. You know, the things just lined up perfectly for them. So
part of me wishes though, like, that they would have held off on those debuts so you could get the fan reaction. But I understand why they did what they did, because they had to advertise it, they had to deliver. So props to AEW for doing that. But right. It's tough.
Yeah, they had advertised the Exalted One for a minute, so they had. I mean, but pulling Matt Hardy, you know, pulling the Matt Hardy rabbit out of their hat was by design, only because they had to even up the odds with Nick Jackson's wife having the baby soon, so they had to get him off TV somehow. And you know, they've always compared the Hardys and the Jacksons anyway, so why not bring in Matt Hardy to replace one of them? So it just made the most sense. All right, 1 hour. 41 minutes, 15 seconds. If you're not watching, hopefully I've got this queued up properly on the video in post. But if I don't, that's where you be. In 3, 2, 1, play. And Gorilla Monsoon is saying one of the biggest conversations coming up right now at WrestleMania 3 is over, of course, Ricky and Randy. And we're seeing here the big dive off the top rope onto the guardrail with Ricky, and the larynx is crushed, brother. Just, and the bell, which is even worse.
Yeah. It's almost like a freaking decapitation right there, like a guillotine. Yeah.
People forget how sadistic Randy Savage could actually be, even back then. He was no joke, man.
That's some hair.
And doctors telling Mean Gene how recovery's going, and Gene's saying, you know, I think the tremendous hearts of Ricky Steamboat. Jesse's going to say, well, no, it's probably because of a tremendous larynx, because his heart wasn't crushed, it was his larynx. Leave it to Jesse. Steamboat coming back to the ring against jobber number 482. I don't know who that is. So I didn't see his face. I don't know who it is, honestly. But apparently somebody mentioned that referee to me, not to me, but on I think it was Pritchard's podcast last week, that he would be one of the guys that Bruce would induct into the Hall of Fame if they inducted referees, because he was around forever. So I forget his name. Sorry, Bruce. You know, my bad. And Animal Steel, obsessed with Elizabeth, carrying her off. And Randy's...
And people might not think too much about, hey, this is kind of carryover from WrestleMania 2 because of the Intercontinental title match that Savage and Steel had the previous year.
Yes, the Savage Steel vendetta had been. Hang on a second, let me hear Randy has to say. I hope to God the video works out on the edit and post production. That way we can have you doing that over Randy doing that in the video. That'd be the greatest thing of all time. History pickings the Macho Man. Oh my God.
See, the best part about that, like, you have to get the motions down and you have to do it right. Like, you can't just, like, you have to, like, do the, like, I don't know, like that's the spirit fingers thing they does, and like have the pinky out and like slowly going across.
The pinky's up, brother. That's it.
They need to bring back that entrance for like a current Mania. Just like somebody coming out in the mini ring and just as like a throwback. I do.
You know what? I am all for that happening in 2021, for the record.
I mean, it may very well.
Hey, no better place than Hollywood for full-on glitz and glamour, right?
Yep. You know, I love how, like, Hogan was the only person who did it.
Our last show when they came out, she just, you know, I made a pitch on social media last week about her being in the Hall of Fame for next year's Mania for a variety of reasons, but
yeah.
I just would love to be there and watch her and her family accept and Hulk or Lanny induct her, because I can't convey enough how important, how much Elizabeth meant to me as a fan in 1991 when her and Randy, now keep in mind, when her and Randy got back together in 91, I'd only been watching since like October. So I wasn't aware of the full scope of the relationship between Randy and Elizabeth. Now, my first ever call CM Home video was SummerSlam 91. So I got the full wedding. I got the full story, you know, all on VHS. And I, you know, to this day, I can't watch WrestleMania 7 without a tear in my eye, as Nate would say, because it's, you know, I know I'm talking over Steamboat. I shouldn't be doing that. But, you know, Ricky's promo is intense and it is meaningful. And he will see new horizons. But yeah, I can't to this day watch WrestleMania 7 without a complete, you know, blubbering mess of a fool up that I am, because the Savage Elizabeth story means so much to me. And having Randy on the show when we did in 2003, prior to his passing, well, way prior to his passing, but, you know, when he was doing his rap career, I've always said Randy was the only person that made my mom mark out. So they mean everything to me. You know, it's, you know, so. Now, if you're watching the video on the network and have us turned down or whatever, you're hearing the Ricky the Dragon Steamboat music that they used back then. I still say they should always pipe in as WWE music to this day.
For this point, they used like the Chicago Bulls theme or something,
right?
Like originally for Steamboat's theme. So like it kind of makes me think of that. Obviously, they can't use that because of like copyright or whatever.
Right.
At the very least, they could have used Ultimo Dragon's theme, but that would have been like anachronistic.
Yeah, and I am not a fan of them using Ultimo's theme for Ricky. It just it doesn't fit. I don't think it fits Ricky personally. Like, I know it's the dragon and, you know, it's, you know, haha whatever, but
I don't know.
I fully endorse them finding a way to bring back his WWE theme, because it's the greatest Ricky Dragon Steamboat theme of all time. Intercontinental title on the line. Here we go, man. It's again, yeah, this is the match that everybody talks about when they talk about WrestleMania 3. Yes, Hogan slammed Andre. It was the slam heard around the world, but you know, halfway through this show, people were going after this. So
yeah. And yes, in 2011, right after Savage passed away, CM Punk had gear that was basically resembling this.
Yes. Very, very very, very cool to see Punk, you know, pay tribute, you know. And yeah, he was still a babyface at that time, so it wasn't, you know, surprising. But
well, now Punk was a heel for that one.
Oh, that's true. When Randy first passed, he was a heel. That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. Okay. I love it. Was such a fast, crazy blur because, you know, he went from, you know, the most hated guy in the company, you know, beating up on Rey Mysterio and picking on his family to, you know, all of a sudden, you know, he could do no wrong.
And if you want arm drag lessons, talk to Ricky Steamboat.
That's it. That's exactly. Yeah. There's arm drag school somewhere in Charlotte that's run by the Steamboat family.
And arm drags aren't anything to shake a stick at. I remember, like, when I was training for wrestling, doing arm drags. Like, right. you like have to like snap really fast and like take the bump. It's like, don't think arm drags are just like, oh, it's a cold spot. They bounce off from it. It's like they're tough. Yeah,
they've been made to believed as, you know, standard fare because guys like Ricky made them look freaking amazing. It's, you know, they almost became commonplace. But you know, when Ricky was doing them, nobody can do an arm drag to this day like Ricky the Dragon Steamboat.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing. Somebody gets a move, somebody makes it popular, and then everybody starts doing it. And then it kind of waters it down. Like the DDT.
I was going to say, that's why DDT's not a finisher anymore.
Yeah. The Canadian Destroyer, that one drives me nuts.
I cannot even believe that is just a random move of them. I mean, you and I came up, you know, in no DQ, you know, working together, whatever, when the Destroyer was a Destroyer, man. If Petey hit that, it was over.
Mm-hmm.
I saw it live at PWG, and it still blew me away to this day. So, it's, And now, it's like, Adam Cole, but something like that now, too, but it's not the same thing, but it's the same type of move, and it's, you know, it's very rarely an ender, a game ender. So, it's very frustrating. I agree.
I mean, it's more like a signature than anything else, but like people doing it just to do it. It's like freaking Ricky Morton does it. It's like, what is happening that a member of the Rock and Roll Express in 2019, 2020, whatever, is doing a freaking Canadian Destroyer?
Yeah, that blows me away. That is so. Hey, you know what? Thing is, though, if anybody's going to pull it off, might as well be Ricky Morton, because Ricky Morton's the coolest guy on the planet. So why not?
Is it terrible? I thought Morton and Gibson had passed away like 20 years ago. I didn't realize they were still... And they're still wrestling!
Yeah. They were wrestling today. Until about 2 months ago,
Of course, that was when I had like
a bunch of... Billy and Lagana for, you know, making them, you know, still be relevant. I think that's so cool. Because, you know, I was so sure when they got inducted by Jimmy a couple of years ago that that was it. They were not going to wrestle anymore. And here they are. Years later, they're still, you know, competing on the indies. Well, not right now, they're not. But and in NWA, so that's awesome.
And winning the NWA Tag Team Championships again.
Yeah, for the ninth time. It's funny you mentioned the tag titles. I attempted to call the NWA out on their history record, shall we say. Because for the longest time, they have negated the reigns that were contested in WCW as far as when Bam Bam and Dr. Death won the tournament, and then they went all the way through until Roma and Arn were the champions, and they broke away from the NWA. Those reigns were not recognized by the current NWA up until when Billy made the purchase. Now, when they did the Crockett Cup and recrowned the champions, I asked them, I said, are you guys recognizing the reigns in WCW? Because you talk about, you know, you're recognizing the histories of the television champions that aren't the same TV title as it was then. Mm. And all I got was history is no history has no twin.
Okay.
Okay.
So. Well, it's funny we bring up the NWA anyway, because less than 2 years later, Steamboat would be on top of the world.
Yeah, and yeah, I actually just watched the NWA 70. The NWA put it up on their YouTube last week in Power's time slot. And Jimmy Cornette talked about, you know, the greatest NWA championship match in Nashville, you know, took place, whatever it was, 30 years before or whatever. And featured a champion, only been champion for a few months, lose the title back to Ric Flair. Of course, that was Ricky. So,
yeah,
I'm glad that this generation is recognizing and being able to be made aware of how great Ricky Steamboat was. Mm-hmm. And that they got to see him at WrestleMania 11 years ago and do the matches with Jericho and the tag match with Piper and Jimmy Snuka. Because Ricky got a bad break when he hurt his back. It was very unfortunate that he had to retire. So look at that. Jeez. But hey, to Randy's credit, man, he caught him right away. That was good.
Yeah.
Usually somebody will skin the cat and they'll get an offensive move. And Randy's like, nope, I'm Randy Savage. It's not happening. Now, if you're not hearing Jesse and Gorilla, you know, you're not hearing, you know, Jesse, you know, complain about Animal Steel interfering, you know, mm-hmm. trying to help Ricky up. And, you know what? Jesse's right.
Yeah.
George was way too involved in this match, I thought.
Oh, yeah.
It doesn't take away from the greatness of the match. I'm just, again, see, he's helping him up. That should have been a 10 count right there. It should have been over. Yeah. So, but you know,
of course, Hebner was busy with Savage. So,
right, Jesse is the only heel commentator that I would go, you know, he's right. By the way, not a fan of the current heel tendencies of Jerry the King Lawler. I think it's like, come on, Jerry, really?
I think he's trying to like yearn for the heel days of old. But it's like,
I guess it's
like it's Attitude Era and like 90s King doesn't really work in this day and age.
Right, yeah. It's one thing to be on commentary with Vince, who is completely 100% pro, you know, babyface and will, you know, fight that battle to his dying breath.
Mm-hmm.
But that was in the 90s when, you know, it was, you know, that was the accepted norm, you know. In 2019, having a Hall of Famer who has done everything in the business, you know, be on the side of the Monday Night Messiah, yeah, no, that's weird.
Did Jesse say Earl Hebner?
He may have. He may have said referee Hebner, and it came out sounding like Earl. I don't know, because I'm pretty sure they hadn't acknowledged. I'm pretty sure Earl was still working for Crockett.
Mm.
Matter of fact, I know he was, because he worked the Bunkhouse Stampede 2 weeks before the main event. So I know he was still working for Crockett then. Does Ricky have something like, oh, yeah, okay, I didn't notice that. He actually has, like, little dragon designs on his booth. It's kind of cool.
Yeah.
I guess just all the color in the ring with Randy's boots and tights. I didn't really, you know, pay attention to Ricky's boots. But, yeah, that's pretty cool. And then there's Animal's sweatshirt there. I'm sorry, he's not wearing a sweatshirt.
Matt Bloom's inspiration.
Exactly. Get away from her, George. What's the matter with you?
Did I point out when we were watching the Steamboat Flair series about Steamboat's like open hand punches?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
I couldn't remember.
I had to hurt. I don't think we ever finished the series though, did we?
I was listening to Ventura's commentary. Oh, what was that?
I don't think we ever finished the Savage, the Steamboat Flair series. We'll have to go back and revisit those.
Yeah.
Hello.
Well,
that's a flying Randy.
Speaking of NWA rules.
Right, yeah. Slight DQ there.
That was always a ridiculous rule, in my opinion.
It really was. I never understood that. Like I get the whole, you know, wanting to be more wrestling-based and more mat-based and not, you know, be so... But in 1992, when Bill Watts took over the book and reinstated the rule, it's like, huh?
Yeah.
And knowing that they didn't get rid of the rule until like 97 or 98. Very bizarre. There's a rare sign out there in the crowd for Ricky. See, not that the sign for Ricky is rare, but just an actual crowd sign period was rare in the 80s.
Until the 90s, everybody had a crowd sign.
Yeah, seriously. It's funny, when they get certain shots of the crowd or like the outside of the ring, you really get a scope for how big this place really was.
Oh, yeah.
It's a damn shame they had to tear it down.
A record that they wouldn't break until technically Mania 32.
Right. Knowing that people I know were there, you know, I mean, Rob was there, RVD was there. So,
yeah.
It's,
I figure.
It's just a lot of people. Like, I'm not good with crowds now, but, you know, if I was a fan at 4 years old, it would have been kind of an interesting thing to be a part of. Just, it's people, again, you know, people will talk about, you know, the technical wizardry here between these two guys. When the NWA is compared to it, I don't know of two better foils for each other in the ring, as characters, as in a storyline, better than Savage and Steamboat here. They just complement each other so well.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and seeing this, you know, really drives home how good Jake the Snake was, because Snake and Jake and Ricky had a great feud prior to this. And of course, Savage and Snake had a great feud later on. It's right. You know, people crap on Jake for what, you know, the dark side, the demon side. But, you know, Jake was very, 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 very underrated, in my opinion, as far as his actual overall performance. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Hello.
Holy cow.
I see we're slightly off sync here.
Yeah. It's okay.
All right.
We're off like by like a second or two, but it's fine.
Yeah, it's fine. Like I said, it'll clean up in post, hopefully. But it's over the elbow. Here we go. It's it. It's over. It's funny. I see that shot and I remember the Kid Rock video, and that was one of the shots in one of the clips. Savage elbow, the Jeff Hardy Swanton, and something else was part of that little montage that they put together. He had him beat, and referee was out of it because now, you know, Gorilla's going to point out, of course, that Savage is the one that knocked the referee down in the first place. So,
yeah.
He's going to the top rope. Here we go. Oh, Animal says not so much. Oh, jeez. No, George, it's bad, George.
Kick right in the back of the head.
Right in the back of the head. You can't do that. That's terrible. And that's the end of you. Now, Gorilla speculates he hit his head on the bell, so that could have been why he's so. Blah, blah, blah. But here we go, and 1, 2, 3, and we have the new Intercontinental Champion, folks. Ricky the Dragon Steamboat has won the Intercontinental title. Oh wait, no, that wasn't the call. I had the arm moment there for a minute. Elizabeth is visibly upset, as she should be. I I forget how short the match was. That was a pretty short match for as soon as it was.
Mm-hmm.
There's Jack Lance down there, the old lech. He's trying to get George trying to get Ricky the hell out of there. I'm going. Goodbye. Let's go. Get on the cart. Move.
Yeah. Don't stand on those. Those aren't like full ring ropes.
No. Those aren't exactly especially rigged for you there, George.
Yeah.
Iconic shot there. With the greatest Intercontinental Championship belt of all time.
Mm-hmm. And it's funny because Steamboat would lose to the greatest Intercontinental Champion of all time.
Yes. We're actually having a discussion about Honky as they show the replay here about Honky the other day about, you know, the fact that Honky Tonk deserved to be in the Hall of Fame more than the guy he inducted 10 years before he did. Sorry, Coco. I will say it till I die, brother.
It just reminds me of what Brett said in the freaking Broken Skull sessions. I threw like powder puff punches.
Oh man, right?
It's like it wasn't like a very long dig. It was just kind of happened in there. It's like, oh damn.
Yeah.
Shades of the Honky Tonk Man.
You know what? I credit Brett as Savage, you know, the spotlight watches Randy Lee without his gold. We will go ahead and pause there, folks. We should be at it doesn't matter because we're signing out there. But it was very interesting that you know, Brett pulled no punches about old Billy Boy.
Well, he didn't pull punches about anything. Yeah.
He did. And you know what? Good for him.
To be fair, Goldberg didn't pull his kick.
People are so quick to, you know, kind of be hesitant to say something. It's like, nah, man, you know what? Bill hurt everybody he wrestled with. Somebody needs to call him out for it.
I don't think you heard my dig right there.
I didn't. What'd you say?
You said Brett didn't pull any punches. I was like, well, Goldberg didn't pull that kick. So,
right. Exactly. Be a very different world if Bill had pulled that kick. So, Anyway, next week, as this airs, it should be the 25th of March. I'm hoping to put it up on the 25th. So, next week will be April 1st, which means we're going into WrestleMania weekend, wherever it may be. And I am thinking we're going to stick to plan, and the plan as of now is to load up on water and throat lozenges because we're watching the Iron Man match from WrestleMania 12, sir.
Mm-hmm.
You are probably my chief Shawn Michaels fan that I talk to on a regular basis. The UN, of course, stat boy, Mike Caldwell.
Yep.
Is that Shawn's greatest match of all time to this day?
No.
Okay.
It's one of his better ones, not his best.
What's that?
It's one of his better ones, but it's not his best.
Right. We've watched many of Shawn Michaels matches as far as you and I over the years, just because, you know, not for the show or whatever, but I have yet to sit down and thoroughly go through this one and actually watch it with, you know, with the eagle eye, if you will. So it'll be fun. It'll be, like I said, get the water ready, get the lozenges ready, and potty, because
yeah,
it won't be a 4-hour interlude, but it'll definitely be an hour, so it'll be interesting.
Wouldn't be the first time we went for an hour in April. It's fun,
right? Just gonna say the same thing. You see, that's why you're the tribute champion and I am but the host. So speaking of that, as we're recording this, I have feelers out there because today is a recording day here at the studio, if you will, so we're hoping to get some responses back. If we do, we will have trivia challenge up after Mania. We'll have those recorded and we'll get them up after WrestleMania because I want to see where things settle once WrestleMania is over and see where the business is going from there and if we're going to go in complete lockdown or what. So, but yeah. I do want content for sure. So we'll get those trivia challenges lined up so you can pull those of them over and we'll see what happens there. So sounds any other plugs, sir?
Go to my Instagram at PA Sensation. Buy a shirt at my Teespring store.
Yes.
Link is in the bio. My live stream is over by the time this goes up, but hopefully I'll be doing more. So go follow the NoDQ.com YouTube channel. Go follow my YouTube channel, YouTube.com/luck of the draw. Because here's my thing with the doing the live streams, doing them on Rift Channel. He has more subscribers than I do. Like,
right.
Easily. He's got like 60 times, if not more, the subscribers that I do. So there's more people watching his channel. So there's got to be more viewership. That's why I do them on his channel, not mine.
Right.
Because I don't have that core audience like he does. So, like, it would be silly of me to just try and do it on mine when I can do them on his channel. So that's why I do it. And he has the ability to super chat, which is what this is for. This little wheel right here, for those of you watching. Yes, lots of good stuff on here. I do professional wrestler entrances, whatever you want. I sing karaoke songs. I pick the songs because I know what I can sing. I do dance breaks. I do, what else do I do? I give away shirts.
Sing the songs, make the whole world sing, Greg?
I sing songs that make the whole world glad they're in quarantine. Because I'm not that great a singer. Like, somebody says, oh, you're not bad. It's like, if I were on American Idol, like, I get the, no, dog, this isn't for you. You know,
are you more leaning toward the William Hung end of things, or are you leaning more toward the pants on the ground type things? That's the thing.
Well, I'm not bad. Like, I'm not going to say, like, I'm the worst thing in the world, but I tried to do, what was it? Like, a year ago, I tried to do freaking Nirvana. I tried to sing a Nirvana song, and that went poorly as expected, because I have, by definition, I have, like, a lower voice. Like, I have a bass singing voice, so
right.
Singing the higher stuff is harder for me, and it sounds like garbage, so.
Yeah.
Well, but
Kurt's a hard, you know, guy to kind of keep up with on the octave levels. You got to keep that in mind too.
But in that same breath, if you want to be entertained by me singing terribly, then there you go.
Exactly.
You get your wish.
We got everybody on the YouTube channels, folks. So stay tuned to that. teespring.com/store/the-night-shift for the official Meachamania shirts, brother. That's it. youtube.com/Jeff Meacham. Of course, you're watching that here. If you know that by now. And you can find me on the audio podcast, Jeff Meacham Network, at anchor.fm/Jeff. I just change it twice. I don't know. It's on there. You'll find it anyway. So, yeah, find me on there.
If you follow Jeff on social media, you'll see all his stuff.
That's right. It'll all be there. So, for Greg Cherry, I am Jeff Meacham. We'll see you next week right here on Wrestling Rewind.